My God, I feel as if your call has left me drifting, wandering, questioning you, this God I follow. Can you provide? Will you keep true? Everything that I have given, when will I receive from you but today? Today I have awoken, still amidst this thick and dreadful darkness, but my delusions of your inability to provide no longer blind my eyes, no longer reflect the darkness of the night sky, but now the millions of glimmering gifts which you have placed in the heavens captivate my reality and force me to ask myself, how can I provide? How can I keep true? If I can't uphold this covenant, then who, Lord? Who?
John Parker was a bad cop. Fellow officers considered him unreliable, and he was continually in trouble with his superiors. Parker was 34, sandy-haired, married, father of three small children, and lived in a modest house at 750 L Street, Washington, D.C. His rookie year, he had been charged with conduct unbecoming an officer, found guilty, and ultimately transferred to another precinct. It went downhill from there, insulting commanding officers, sleeping on duty, drunk and disorderly, you name it. John Parker had been accused of it. He was, however, never let go, but always reprimanded and reassigned. The assignment on April 14th was easy enough, maybe too easy, as later Parker would explain boredom as one of the reasons he left his post that evening at the theater and walked across the street to Taltaville's Star Saloon to meet up with his drinking buddies. He did not know that one of the men with the bottle of whiskey at the bar was drinking to prepare him to use the Derringer pistol in his coat pocket. And that's just what he did, as John Wilkes Booth walked out of that bar and into Ford's Theater on April 14th, 1865, and shot President Abraham Lincoln, whose bodyguard, John Parker, was missing in action. Now, although you may have never heard the name John Parker before today, his story and the story of his life is inseparably linked to the assassination of President Abraham Lincoln. And today, as Kevin just told you, we begin a brand new series of messages leading all the way up to Easter. And each week, we are going to focus on a life story, a story of a life like Abraham's that you just saw in the promo video. A story of a life that has its own story, but is especially interesting because of the way it intersects the story of Easter. Every single story, all the way back to Abraham that we will look at, foretell the events that were to take place on Easter Sunday. Now, the season of Lent, maybe you grew up in a tradition that celebrated Lent and you gave up things for Lent. Maybe you didn't eat meat or you gave up chocolate or something like this. And that was to prepare you to celebrate appropriately on Easter. And instead of focusing on what we're going to give up, we are going to focus on stories. The stories of different lives. The stories of lives in the Scripture. Because by the time we get to Easter, almost everyone who walks through these doors knows what I'm going to say. I'm going to say, Jesus died and he rose again. And no one's going to say, what? It won't be shocking news, probably to anyone. And that's important, that Jesus died and rose again. It is an event that our faith is based on, which I've said before is very, very important. That the Christian faith is not primarily based on a philosophy or a morality or a ritual. It's primarily based on an event that happened. And we can have great discussions about why I believe it happened. And I love talking about that because I do believe that it happened. But this series of messages that we launch into today is going to assume for a while that it happened. And it's going to ask the question, why? Why did it happen? Not philosophically why, but practically. Why did Jesus die and rise again? And we will discover on our journey that there were people and actions leading up to the event that made the event of Easter almost inevitable. And if we are to prepare ourselves to celebrate appropriately, we need to know those stories. We're calling the whole thing Person of Interest. How many of you have seen the TV show Person of Interest? Great, like six. Oh, no, there's more of you. Look, you just weren't playing along at first. I'm so glad. But it doesn't matter if you've seen the TV show is one that's not even on anymore. You can get it on Netflix. And it was about each episode was about a life. And the life that you were introduced to was either going to be a perpetrator or a victim. And you weren't sure which. But it didn't take very long in watching the show before you figured out that really the story was this backstory. There was this greater mystery that was unfolding. And the individual stories were just clues as to how this backstory was going to unfold. And the same is going to be true for us each week. We're going to look at a life. And the life has an interesting story, and I think that you will see yourself in the story of the life that we pick each week. But the greater interest is this backstory and how each life points to the cross. And even though most of the people that we'll talk about were unaware that they would be connected with this one event, with this story, the story of all stories, they are. And that's your story. That's my story, too. Did you know that? So we all have a story. We could go around. We'll start with Kevin. Kevin, tell you. No, I'm just kidding. We all have a story, right? Some of them more interesting than others. Some of them more tragic than others. But it, just like the stories that we're going to, in the end, your story and mine will be defined by how it intersects the story. And so we're going to launch in today. Our first story is the story of Abraham. And his name was Abram before he got switched to Abraham. And my premise is this. There's a little Abraham in all of us. And so that's why hopefully you got one of these on the way in that says, hello, my name is Abraham. And you're thinking, my name's not Abraham. I'm not going to put this on. But by the time I'm finished, I hope you'll go, oh, hello, my name is Abraham. There's a lot of Abraham actually in me. And the challenge is to recognize how his story is like our story. So that's what we're going to do today. Where do we find his story? In the book of Genesis. So if you have a Bible and want to follow along, you can look really spiritual because Genesis is easy to find. It's the first book in the Bible. You just open it up and there it is, Genesis. And you look like, I read this all the time. And so you can find Genesis. I'm going to start in Genesis chapter 15. We'll do a little backstory here in a second. But this is the story of Abraham and then a miraculous encounter that he has with God. Genesis chapter 15, verses, well, I'm going to read the whole chapter. Here we go. After this, the word of the Lord came to Abram, same guy as Abraham. Do not be afraid, Abram. I am your shield, your very great reward. But Abram said, Sovereign Lord, what can you give me since I remain childless? And the one who will inherit my estate, Eleazar of Damascus. And Abraham said, You have given me no children. So a servant in my household will be my heir. Then the word of the Lord came to him. This man will not be your heir, but a son, who is your own flesh and blood, will be your heir. He took him outside and said, Look up at the sky and count the stars, if indeed you can count them. Then he said to him, So shall your offspring be. Abram believed the Lord, and he credited it to him as righteousness. He also said to him, I am the Lord, who brought you out of Ur of the Chaldeans, to give you this land and to take possession of it. But Abram said, Sovereign Lord, how can I know that I will gain possession of it? So the Lord said to him, Bring me a heifer, a goat, a ram, each 3 years old, along with a dove and a young pigeon. Abram brought all these to him, cut them in two, and arranged the halves opposite each other. The birds, however, he did not cut in half. Then birds of prey came down on the carcasses, but Abram drove them away. As the sun was setting, Abram fell into a deep sleep, and a thick and dreadful darkness came over him. Then the Lord said to him, Know for certain that for 400 years your descendants will be strangers in a country not their own, and that they will be enslaved and mistreated there. But I will punish the nation they serve as slaves, and afterward they will come out with great possessions. You, however, will go to your ancestors in peace and be buried at a good old age. In the fourth generation, your descendants will come back here, for the sin of the Amorites has not yet reached its full measure. Verse 17. When the sun had set and darkness had fallen, a smoking firepot with a blazing torch appeared and passed between the pieces. On that day, the Lord made a covenant with Abram and said, "To your descendants I will give this land, from the Wadi of Egypt and the great river, the Euphrates, the land of the Kenites, the Kenizzites, the Kadmonites, the Hittites, the Perizzites, the Raphites, the Amorites, the Canaanites, the Girgashites, the Budlites, and the Jebusites." Just want to see if you're listening. Amen. This is the word of the Lord. Thanks be to God. And it might seem confusing to you at first, but this breaks down into these two sections. Verses 1 to 8 explain in some detail the fears and doubts of Abraham. And they're right there for us on display. And then verses 9 through the end of the chapter record for us the promises and the assurance of God. I want you to see both of those things, because I want you to see your story in Abraham. So first, there's the doubts and fears of Abraham, verses 1 to 8. Starts with verse 1, where God shows up and says the most common thing that God says when God shows up, which is what? Fear not. Now, why do you tell people to not be afraid? Because they have a propensity to be afraid, right? And most of the time, in my experience, it's too late by the time you say it. And that would have been true of Abraham, I think. God said, "Fear not." If I was Abraham, I'd have been like, "Too late. I'm already afraid." And we might ask, well, why? What does Abraham have to be afraid of? And we'd have to go back a couple of chapters. In chapter 12, Abram, not yet Abraham, is just a normal shepherd guy living in a town called Ur. And it sounds just like it sounds, right? Ur. It's in the middle of nowhere. And God comes to him and calls him out and says, "Abram, I want you to leave. I'm going to make you the father of many nations, and you need to come and follow me." And Abram says, "Where?" And God says, "I'll tell you after we start going." And when I tell you that story, no one in here is shocked and in awe. Why? Because it's a Bible story to you. I want you to think with me for a second. These are real people this happened to. So let me talk to just the men in the room for just a second, okay? Guys, imagine for a second if during this service you heard from the Lord. You, and I can tell by the way your arms are crossed and you're looking at me like this, that you're ready to hear a word from the Lord. That you go home and you walk in to your wife and you say, "Honey, God spoke to me today." And she says, "Okay, what did he say?" And you say, "He said we should sell all of our stuff and our house and pack up the minivan and leave all of our kids and all of our neighbors and my work and all of that, and we should just leave." "Okay, and go where?" "Well, he didn't tell me that yet." Now, what would your wife say? I know, "Fear not," somebody said. No, I know. You got a good Crossroads wife, and she would say, leader of the household, I will follow you." Anyway, not mine either. I get it. This is what happens to Abram. He comes in and says, "Hey, baby, God has told me that we're supposed to leave Ur and go somewhere," right? Add to that, it says when God gave him this command, Abram was 75 years old. 75. Now, I'm going to stop right here for a second. You're going to just play along for a second. Could you do this for me? If you are here this morning and you are 70 or older, would you stand up just for a second? I know that you're here, a couple of you. Thank you. Stand up. Stay stay standing. Come on. Stay standing. Can you give these guys a hand? Stay standing. All right, you can sit down. Thanks, Ed. Let me tell you why. Well, first, can I just say this? Thank you, thank you, thank you, thank you. Thank you for being here. Thank you for being part of Crossroads in whatever part that you play. We are so grateful for you. You know, most of the time they say that spiritual revival starts with the young people. They get all excited and then the excitement spreads and all that. And that's true. And we love young people. But thank the Lord there are a few of you here and we're not all 20-year-olds. 1,500 20-year-olds gathering this morning would be enough to do me in. Can I tell you? And I understand that every time we gather, that we gather and stand on the shoulders of your spiritual foundation. So thank you for being a part of this. Now, all of you that just stood up, how would you respond if God showed up and said, I'm not through with you, you're still going to have a kid? Fear not. Now, does that have a whole new meaning now? In verse 1, God shows up and says, fear not. Now, what does Abraham have to fear? Well, if God's command to fear not was based on Abram's circumstances, he could just pull out his list. What do I have to fear? Well, let me go through the list. We don't know where we're going. We have no land. We just made a bunch of powerful people really angry because I had to rescue my crazy Uncle Lot from this group of people in Sodom and Gomorrah. And by the way, we don't have any ancestors. We don't have any kids. And by the way, I'm 75. Fear not. Fear not. But listen, God's command to Abraham, or his command to us to fear not, is not based on the circumstances. Because if they were, it would be ridiculous. It's based on who he is. It's based on his character. It's based on the never-changing aspect of who God is. Who God is never changes and is completely reliable. So does that make Abraham not doubt? Of course not, nor do it does make you not doubt. It's a good start. But Abraham still doubts. And what does he doubt? Well, first of all, he doubts God, right? So first of all, God says, I'm going to give you descendants. And Abraham basically says, where's the kid? I don't have a son, and I have this neighborhood kid, Eleazar. He just comes and eats all the food, and he's going to get everything that I have. Where's the promise, God? The circumstances tell me that this is not going well. He doubts God. And I want to pause just for you to understand, how does God respond to someone who doubts? Does he grab him by the shirt, like, you little snit, come over here. I put this world together. I'll take you out. Is that what he? No. That's not what he says. Does he also say, oh, I understand. Life's so hard. You're going to doubt. I understand. No. See, he doesn't do either of those things, which I think culturally are the two options that most of the time we're given when it comes to doubt. Is one, maybe some of you grew up in an environment where it was not okay to doubt ever anything about God. To bring up a question, you were frowned upon. And in my experience, those kind of environments, they produce skeptics. They don't take care of them. They don't give answers. They don't bolster faith. They just create skepticism. And God doesn't do that. God doesn't slap you around and say, stop all that doubting. Neither does God do the other thing that I think culturally sometimes becomes in vogue, which is make doubting a virtue. Like, just doubt everything all the time. And neither does God do that. God takes Abraham, says, look up at the sky. I made that. I'm going to make all the kids. I'm still in control, God. If you have doubts, God treats us the same way. It's okay. It's okay to question. It's okay to ask. It's okay. And God will continually move us in the direction of explaining, of not explaining as much as revealing who he is. Not so much everything that's going to happen, but who he is and why we can trust him. So number one, Abraham doubts God. And he lives to tell about it. But number two, And then maybe this is more interesting to you. I think Abraham doubts himself, right? I mean, if you're 75 and somebody comes to you and says, you're still going to have a kid, wouldn't there be a little doubt about you? Like, you're going to be involved in the process. And you're thinking, okay, well, even if I trusted you, I'm not sure I trust me. Like, have you seen me? Have you seen my wife? And this, I'm not sure I understand. So I think Abram not only doubts God, I think he doubts himself. And I think that the reality is, for most of us, those things are all wound up together. Sometimes it's hard to pull them apart and identify which part is the doubt about me and which part is the doubt about God, because usually God's trying to use me to do something. And God says, you're going to be a great nation. And I think Abraham doubts God, but I think he also doubts himself, and he thinks, I can't even keep my crazy relatives in line. How am I going to lead a whole nation? And so, what do you do when you have some doubts about God and they are all wound up in some doubts that you have about you? What do you do then? In case that's appropriate for anyone in the room besides me, let's watch. Because what you do is you look at the promises and the assurances of God, which start in verse 9. And so with all of that, God's response is, Abram, bring me a heifer, which is, you know, great counsel if you have these doubts. Go get a heifer and a sheep and a ram and a pigeon and a dove, which he does without any further instruction. Did you notice that? He just there brings them back, starts cutting animals in half. And if you were listening, you would be thinking, wait a minute. There's something going on here that apparently Abram and everyone reading it would have understood completely, but I have no idea what's actually going on here. So we need to understand a few things. You need to know a few things about a covenant, which is what was going on there. The biblical language is actually this, to cut a covenant. Now, in our world, when two people make a binding agreement, sometimes it's called a contract. Sometimes we still use the word covenant where? In a marriage, right? And people make a covenant with one another. And in a written culture, the way that you do that most often is you sign on the dotted line. You say, I agree to these stipulations. Here's what will happen. And I sign on the dotted line. Well, in an oral culture, what they did is they acted it out. They had a little drama. You drama people are all excited now. And they acted it out. What would happen if I didn't hold up my end of the agreement, this binding agreement? What would happen? And so often they would bring an animal, and the animal would be cut in two. Imagine actually cut in two, blood, everything. And the animal would be placed in two halves. And then the members who were the two parties that were making this agreement, they would walk through the center of this blood path of this animal, and they would say basically this, if I don't hold up my end of the agreement, may this happen to me. I am serious about this. And they would stomp through this path, right? And so that would be the drama that was about to play out here. Now, you need to know something about the animals. There's five of them that God asks Abram to go get. And they turn out that they are the five animals that are going to be used in the sacrificial system. Now, later on, the sacrificial system was used in worship. And depending on what kind of family you were from and what the occasion was, there would be a different animal that would be prescribed for you to sacrifice as a part of worship in the Old Testament. And it turns out that all of them are represented here. So, in effect, God starts the whole thing off by saying, this is going to be a promise and agreement for everybody, all kinds of people, for all time, not just for Abram. So I want you to bring all the animals here, and we're going to make one whopper of a promise to one another. Last thing you need to know about a covenant. You need to know that sometimes a covenant was agreed upon between a person of high standing, a king, and a vassal. So in other words, if a king would go and they would conquer a land, maybe the people in power in that land, they would reach out to the king. Their lives had been saved, and they would make a covenant with the king. Well, in that case, the king didn't walk. You understand? So the king would sit on the throne, and the vassal would come and make this promise. And it was just grateful that the king would allow him to be in a covenant. And so the vassal would walk through, saying, if I don't hold up my end of the bargain, I understand what's going to happen to me. And the king would say, very good, you know, I'd receive this covenant. Which, think with me, that has to be what Abraham has in his head. God says, go get these animals. Abraham cuts them in half. Can you imagine the scene? And God's presence is there, and Abram is looking and thinking, oh boy, I'm about to make a promise that says, I will serve God only, completely, never swerving. I am going to be all in for Yahweh God. And if I don't, it's really obvious what I'm saying is going to happen to me. How would you be feeling at this moment? Well, we don't have to wonder how he was feeling. I'll look it up for you. Verse 12. That's the wrong passage. I already said it's at the beginning of the Bible, dummy. Verse 12. As the sun was setting, Abram fell into a deep sleep, and a thick and dreadful darkness came over him. You know that word? It means terrified. He was terrified. Why was he terrified? Because he knew what he was about to promise or being asked to promise. And he knew him. And I know me. And there's a little Abraham in all of us. And so he stands there terrified. And here's, I think so many people in our day have this picture of what faith is supposed to look like. Like you're standing there, and God's on his throne, and you're supposed to say, I promise I will always do the right thing, and I will always be a good person, and if I don't, I imagine you're going to whack me. And I think that's the lion's share of our culture, thinks that's what faith looks like. And Abraham, and you, and me, and we stand there, and we hesitate, and we go, oh, I guess so. Except for, he was wrong. That picture is wrong. The whole setup was wrong. Wrong, wrong, wrong. And it plays out in such a beautifully powerful way. Look with me. So God gives a little speech about how he knows everything that's about to happen, and he's in control. And then in verse 17, look what it says. When the sun had set and darkness had fallen, a smoking firepot with a blazing torch appeared and passed between the pieces. Now, this is the visible expression of the presence of God. The smoking firepot, when God came down on Mount Sinai, right, and the Ten Commandments and all that, and the smoke filled the whole place. When God led the people through the desert out of slavery, there was this pillar of fire. It says it was like a lightning bolt that never flashed. It was just the whole time. Imagine that. And it says that's what showed up. This expression of who God is. And so not only did God not stay on his throne, God goes first. It says God goes through. And depending on which commentator you want to believe, God goes through first, and then maybe God goes through second if you split the two things apart. But whether God went through first or first and second, it's really clear who doesn't go through. Who doesn't go through? You can look at it again. Abram never walks through the path. It says verse 18, and therefore God made a covenant. What's he saying? He's saying, I am the God of the universe, and if I should not hold up my promise, may this happen to me. May I be cut into. May I be destroyed. And if you don't hold up your end of the bargain, may this happen to me. I am going through. I'm making the promise for you. This is an unconditional covenant of grace. God says the promise is all about me and my commitment to you. God, how can this be? See, we know something that Abraham didn't know. If you fast forward to Mark chapter 15 and Jesus is on the cross, darkness comes again. That terrifying darkness. Because why? Because God made good on his promise. Do you see it? Jesus was cut off. Jesus did suffer in my place. God was making good on his promise at the cross. So all the way back in this covenant with Abraham, God knew what it would take. He knew. He wasn't caught off guard. There was not some confluence of events beyond God's control that made Easter happen. God knew exactly what was happening. There was no other way. It was inevitable. From the time that God made that covenant, the cross was going to happen. And you should know that if you're going to celebrate Easter appropriately. Now, from that time on, the Jewish people would gather and worship. And when they would worship, they had a sacrificial system, and an animal often was sacrificed as a part of their worship. But when they did that, listen. When they would sacrifice an animal, they were not naively thinking that somehow the gods were appeased because they had offered up this life. Not at all. What were they saying? They were remembering this promise and the way that God made this unconditional promise of grace. And every time they worshiped and this animal blood was spilled, they said, "Oh God, please keep your promise, because that's the only way we have any hope. Oh God, please include me in the promise, because that's the only way I have any hope. I want to be like Abraham. I want to be included, not because of my faithfulness, but because of yours." Every time they worshiped, they were reminded of that. And Easter is the fulfillment of that promise, where you and I get to say, "Praise God, he kept his promise. I'm included." Now, I said at the beginning, you might want to pull out your little Abraham sticker now. I lost mine. There it is. You might want to pull this out. Because I said at the beginning, there's a little Abraham in all of us. Maybe now you see why. Now, Abraham, who became Abraham, went on to live a really fantastic life. It was not perfect, however. He did not uphold all of the standards of God all the time for his entire life. He did, however, have a kid. He had a son named Isaac. Isaac had a son named Jacob. Jacob had a son named Joseph. And in that line came King David, among others, and eventually came Jesus Christ. When the story of Abraham is retold by the Apostle Paul in his letter to this Roman church, the church spreads in the first century all the way to Rome, and Paul is writing to this group, and here's what he says about Abraham. Listen to these words. We'll stop here. "Yet he," talking about Abraham, "did not waver through unbelief regarding the promise of God, but was strengthened in his faith and gave glory to God, being fully persuaded that God had the power to do what he had promised." No mention, you can look it up, by the Apostle Paul of the time that Abraham got chicken and made his wife pretend that she was his daughter, or his sister instead of his wife. No mention of that. No mention that Abraham actually slept with his wife's servant because he couldn't wait for God to make good on his promise, so he took matters into his own hands. No mention of that. Did all that happen? Yep. But here's the story. Here's Abraham's story and mine and yours. His story is defined and remembered as it intersects the story, the story of the cross. And the story of the cross is one of redemption, is one of restoration, is one of new beginnings. My story, I'm a lot like Abraham, is not one of the past mess ups and the ways that I have blown it and the ways that I have not been faithful. Is that true of me? You bet it is. But that's not my story. So I got a little Abraham in me. And my story is defined by its intersection with the story of the cross, the story of Easter, and so is yours. So here's what we're going to do. I'm going to share with you a story of someone today whose life, even though circumstances and doubts existed, is defined by their intersection with Jesus. Then we're going to have the worship team come back up. We're going to sing a last song. And during this time, maybe you want to take this little name tag. And for some of you here this morning, you came in and the circumstances in your life were preventing you from trusting God. And you know it as clear as day. And you might want to just write your name over top of Abraham. Say, I can still trust God in spite of my circumstance that right now does not look the way I thought it should look. Or some of you came in this morning and your doubts were more about you than about God. Let's be honest. Now you write your name on top of there. Maybe you write, fear not. Too late. Okay. Fear not. And as we sing this last song in a few minutes, if you'd like to come up, this is not everybody, but for some of you, this will be so meaningful. Take it off. You stick that name tag right on the cross. There's a cross on either side of the room. Just a personal time, you and the Lord. We'd invite you to do that. Let's pray, and I'll show you Mike's story, and we'll end. Father, thank you for the story of Abram. I got a little Abraham in me. Thank you for the promise of your unconditional love, your covenant of grace, the promise that doesn't depend on my faithfulness but yours. Thank you that I get included in that. Thank you in Jesus' name. Amen. Here's Mike's story.
Hi, my name is Mike. My life was mainly all about me. It was all about me. I thought it wasn't selfish. I thought I wanted the same things that a lot of people wanted for my wife and my kids. I built up a mortgage company, had 30 or 40 employees, had a big house, nice pool, nice cars, great friends. I thought all these things were important. At no point was God ever a part of my life. This was my life, not his. There was no room for him. It was all about me and what I wanted and what I wanted for my family. All the money, the power, the self-importance eventually caught up to me. And as many of you know, the mortgage industry crashed in 2008. And along with that, did my business. And everything that I had built up and thought was important came crashing down like a weak house of cards. During that whole crash with the mortgage industry, I took some shortcuts, did a lot of things that were wrong, and I actually ended up in jail. I still didn't know what it meant to have a relationship with God or to even turn your whole life over to God and give him control of my life. I was nowhere near ready for that, but I did know that things that I were doing and how I was running my life weren't working out so well. September 14th, 2014, it was in Westminster, and I heard Reed give his message, and it really felt like he was talking directly to me. It felt like he was talking right at me. I eventually decided on December 27th that year to get baptized. I still had one outstanding legal issue that I was trying to take care of. I went through the new members thing for the month of January. February 1st was the last day. The next day I went to court in Harford County. At that point, I really truly believed that I had accepted Jesus Christ as my Lord and Savior, and that I was in a process of surrendering to him and giving things up to him. It was a slow process, but I was in the process of doing that. Judge gave me 5 years, DOC time, which means state prison. I went to state prison, and it was pretty much a shock. I thought I was moving in the right direction. I thought, you know, everything I was doing was the right thing to do. But like I said, I was greatly disappointed. Even though I trusted Christ, things weren't going the way I thought they would. They were going to go. At that point, I could, as a believer, I could either wallow in my own self-pity, or I could look to God and His and my circumstances and decide to make the best of it. As much as I didn't want to go to prison, or I would have chose probably a different direction for my salvation, I don't regret any of it because of where I am today. Because of my relationship with God and how He's used me and the circumstances that I went through to make me a better man and to further His kingdom.